Good afternoon, everybody. This is Dilip coming again. Thank you for joining the webinar series and welcome back. In last first session of this webinar series, the Project Success Foundation, I'll just do a quick review, recap for you for around 5 minutes. And then for next 40 minutes, I will try to deep dive inside the common problems that are normally occurring while responding to requests for proposal or requests for tenders or quotations. And towards the end, around 10 to 15 minutes, we will cover the questions. So in the first session, I set up the background, the context, and why we really require to focus on this subject. And we started with what is project success? And we actually sketched three scenarios. One is on a time and material based simple resource provisioning. The second one is the fixed bid projects, where you have done a pre-commitment of efforts, duration, and others commitments. And then there are announced projects which are beyond the fixed bid, trying to really deliver or achieve the business goals, delivering the results. The amount of effort that you have consumed for the particular IT project is important, but the more important part is the business goals. And we covered these three scenarios, and we have found that the performance of the IT project performance, as surveyed by various agencies and in particularly by IBM, is not so well great. Now, as we move from time and material to business goal achievement type of scenarios, the demands and the risk go up, but as well as the rewards also increases. And those rewards are not only for the organization, the vendors, in our case, the outsource vendors who are giving the services to the customer, not only they are keen to achieve that success from a increasing the top line and bottom line perspective for gaining the right customer delight and customer satisfaction score, and it in turn creating a reference for new business either from the same customer or from the new customers that come into picture. But the success of the project is also equally important for we as an individual, because it allows us to work on a complex projects and thereby boost our careers. At the same moment, if it can allow us to achieve our work-life balance, then we will enjoy both the sides of the world. Now, in order to happen that, we covered what could be our success definition. Our success definition will be the projects which we will call successful if it is on time and within effort delivered. Within effort budget delivered. It meets or exceeds the customer expectation. It achieves a net promoter score, which is sort of representing the customer readiness to give a reference. It achieves the net promoter score greater than it. And then it allows us to work up value chain. That means we are working in the area of problem definition, requirement definitions, solution architecting, designing, and so on and so forth, including program management and a large and complex project management areas. And then last but very important is the enhancing the work-life balance. Now, if we want to achieve a project which is successful on all these criteria, then we saw there are 5 important aspects which we need to take care of. First and foremost, the scope of the work should be very clearly defined. Both the functional and activity scope should be clearly defined. The realistic estimations should be there, not too pessimistic, not too optimistic, but giving us a right amount of effort budget and duration budget is expected. Then we are working on a most suitable solution which will get the customer satisfaction, but as well as will help the customers to achieve their business goals is very important. We can establish a change management is another fourth aspect that we need to take care of. And in all, right from the proposal stage to the project closure stage, we should be able to manage the risk. Now, these are five, does not mean it's a comprehensive list, but these are five critical enablers, five critical aspects that we should be really working on. And if we can do that, then our chances of project being successful is very high. Now, the question is, when do we all do all this? Actually, most of these aspects we can take care of during the proposal stage, not only while writing the proposal, but post to that, defending, negotiating, and contracting based on the proposal. All that comes in the proposal stage or a pre-sale stage, if I can say. And if we can clearly address these major aspects of project success, then our proposal is not just winning, but our proposal lays the solid foundation that we require for project to be successful in terms of customer satisfaction and business goals of both customers and us. So that is why I say that proposals and contracts are the foundation stones for the successful project. But what we have observed in the last, I just covered quickly, that while most of the time we respond to the RFPs, we do it in a very hurried manner, and therefore there could be some challenges or problems that are created during the proposal writing stage. So today I am now going to cover what we will be doing in the proposal and what problems normally face during the proposal writing. I want to do this today so as to deep dive into the problem area. And once we understand the problems or challenges that occur during the proposal writing stage, in the next session, I'll try to give you an overview of various solutions that can be brought into picture. So today is a more of defining the problem, challenges that we face, risks, some of the risks that we have that I'm going to cover. So with that, I will start my first deadly sin that I want to share with you is failing to qualify the deal. Many a times, we do not know enough about the customer. We do not know what their buying process is, who is the current vendor who is supplying that services or solution. Are the customer really happy or are not happy with the current provider? What are the business drivers? Why customer wants to really implement that particular IT solution or service it or support it or maintain it? What are the business drivers behind that? Both from a point of view of implementing the solution as well as the drivers that are there for outsourcing to the external vendors. So many things that are not known to us. What results do the prospect hope to achieve, or various results they might want to achieve, which is out of the various results that they want to achieve, which one of them are the most? Are they concerned more about the cost, which is normally what we imagine? But several times, you know, the customers are more keen on a high quality, well secured IT solution as compared to the cost of the solution that is coming up, and it should be noted very well. In case we do not know most of these aspects, then our chances are very, very low of winning. In fact, 1 out of 20 business proposals win. That is why the win ratios are really very low. In another words, if we are trying to respond to an RFP without having a knowledge of the customer, your chances of losing are as high as 95%. Please know that, as high as 95%. That is why the response, the win ratios are very low. You spend a lot of efforts, time and money in your pre-sales activities, but then it becomes a frustrating game. Now, several times there is another question which is not really clear about it. Simply because the customer has requested a proposal by means of issuing an RFP, request for proposal, or request for quotation. Does that mean the customer is really serious about it? Well, we assume it, and we may rightly do so. However, several times the customers may be interested, may have already decided who they are going to partner with, and the RFP is issued for the general purpose, or more for a SOX compliance, or more for, you know, getting the silver bullet, if at all available in the market, that type of considerations. So it may not be that a customer is really serious, but it's not always. I mean, please note there, I'm not saying it is always that the customers behave in that fashion, but it is likely. There may be a chance that the customer is trying to really collect the information and augment it or further use it for already predefined directions and predefined a vendor partner that they have thought about. Now, another thing that we need to really work about, and sometimes it is a question of a matter of experience of our company and expertise, is whether we are really competitive to address the RFP. The complexity of the technology, the latest bleeding technologies on which we are working, as well as the solution domain demands, sometimes really are quite challenging, and we may not be the exact people to match the requirement, both domain-wise as well as technically. Sometimes there are very stringent contractual requirements. I recollect in one case, the customer was really keen on signing up unlimited liability clauses. That means if our solution fails during the execution, during the production period, and whatever loss that they will incur, the vendor has to really bear for. Now, such a stiff contractual requirement, you may not be really keen on that. So, are we really competitive, or are we will be able to address this, is one of the things that we need to really look into. So, if we fail to qualify the solution in various aspects like this, please note our chances of winning that deal is very low. Having said so, let's turn now to the second deadly sin: not focusing on what the customer wants. Now, this is a typical thing that I have seen often. So, you know, the customer would like to see that we have understood the problem and we have right type of a solution. Now, where do the customer start getting that insight? It is while reading the executive summary. Please note, executive summary is the most critical section of the proposal. I normally say 8-second web page and 8-minute executive summary rule. That means within first 8 seconds, if the web page does not attract the user, it is likely the person will click to the next site. Similarly, if within first 8 minutes, that is while reading the executive summary, if you fail to get the attention of a customer, the likelihood that you are not only just executive summary, but your entire proposal will get disqualified. It's a very important section that we really require to. But, and please also note that executive summary is read by not only critical decision makers, but also all other stakeholders like technical buyers or a procurement people or a finance people or legal people. So therefore, executive summary is one such section which is referred by everybody. And it completely gives the layout of your story very, very, very nicely. But many a times I have seen executive summaries are focused on the vendor's own company history or the products or various other accolades or achievements that we have, are rarely focusing on what the customer wants. And the starts of not focusing here, it starts right in the executive summary. That we call this as a chest thumping executive summary or chest thumping proposal. In one case, I have seen out of a 35-page proposal, first 14 pages we are talking about the vendor's own, you know, company history, structure, lines of business, and so on and so forth, it is impossible that any buying team member will have a patience to go to the 15th page and start knowing that the customer, the vendor actually has understood the problem and is providing the solution. So therefore, self-centered, chest-thumping proposals have a very minimal chances. But surprisingly, around 30% of the proposal actually start with a corporate overview and the statement like we are very happy to respond to you and all those times. They never come back right on the point that the customer, the customer is cared about. So not just executive summary, the entire thing is very important, but from first initial things like the cover letter or the title of the proposal is also equally important in gaining or in really showing your customer centricness or your customer oriented work on the executive of the proposal. So for example, instead of titling the proposal as proposal for server virtualization, which is too bland to my knowledge, if we write something like increasing profitability and throughput in data center, a recommendation for service virtualization. Now, the title makes a lot of difference, as you are aware about any other movie that film movies do have carry that. So therefore, you know, the cover letter, the title, the executive summary, and the entire structure of a proposal, it's a neat story that is written in with keeping customer in the center, their needs being established, their a solution expectation well considered. I think then we can see that we are focusing on customer. Otherwise, it's not that we are. So see that if we do this, we show that we have not only concerned with your problems, but we have very confident about the solution that we are proposing. Now that will lower the anxiety of the in the buying process and increase the customer trust in us. Starting with our company history or overview of our products does the exact opposite. If we talk the customer language, we are likely to get a much better response. So, having covered the second scene, let's see the third one. Third one is not structuring the document or persuasively. Our persuasion is the thing that we are going to cover in depth in the third seminar, in the third webinar, which is the art and science of a persuasion. But persuasion means what? Now, we are all tuned towards seeing the information in a right way, in a right manner. Now, supposingly, if we are looking the information just for the gaining more insight in terms of any product and not for decision making, then our structure can be an informative. But let's say if we are to do a decision based on the document that we are referring, in our case it will be a proposal and annexes, then the structure should be persuasive. Now what is persuasion? Persuasion is actually providing a right information to the right people in a right manner, so that you know the buying members actually get convinced that we have a right solution, and that right solution will do win-win both for the customer as well as the vendor. So I'll repeat this. It is the right information provided to the right people in a right manner, so that the buying members see that we have a right solution which will create a win-win proposal both for the customer as well as the vendor. Now, if we are helping the customers to take that informed decision with a right understanding and language, then that document is persuasive. It helps the customer to take that decision, and mostly in favor of us, and that is what. So a persuasive document or a proposal has a typical structure. There are four aspects or four sections or four points or four major areas that you should be covering in. First and foremost, you should summarize your understanding of the customer needs, what the problem is, what your experience tells further in it, what areas the customer might have missed that should be also considered, what risk, and so on and so forth. Summarizing your understanding in the customer language and not in technical language, more in domain language, help the customer to get that insight that the vendor does understand my problem. And that is a first step towards attracting the mindshare or getting the right mindshare of a customer. The second is what could be the outcomes coming out of the solution that we have. So when we describe the problem or when we define the problem in right language, we get customer attention. But when we show what could be the outcomes coming up, then we get a customer commitment. Please note here that at any given company, there are dozens of problems that the customer is trying to solve. And of course, everybody has got their budget constraint. Now in that scenario, why should the customer prioritize to solve this problem, which we are trying to provide solution for, is dependent upon how good the outcomes are convincing. Are we getting a right return on investments? Is the payback period minimum? Is the business goal achievement ability is increased? And so on and so forth. All those outcomes are very important. If we make a convincing story of that outcomes, then the customer's commitment goes up leaps and bounds, and therefore the customer will prioritize to work on this. Then recommending a right solution, and this is very important part, that the solution is the most important aspects. Just committing the outcomes is not enough, but showing a right solution that will confidently state that how we can achieve the outcomes is a very, very important part of it. But the last is providing the evidence that we as a vendor company has not only got the solution painted for you, we're not only committing you the outcomes, but we have a right experience, competence, tools, technology, methods, processes, techniques, project management, and program management abilities. With that, we have confidence, and that demonstrates to the customer that we will be able to show or will be able to deliver the solution within the budget, both of time and money, as well as achieving all the objectives, whether they are business objectives or whether they are IT objectives. If our proposal can do this, then I can call this proposal as a persuasion. But many a times we do not see the proposals are really persuasive. They are not structured in that manner in which I was just now describing. And therefore, I call that as a third deadly sin of the proposal writing. Having done that, I will quickly move to fourth deadly sin, which must be on your screen just now. It is inability to differentiate both your offer as well as your company. You know, now I have been in the customer shoes also, and I have seen several other customers doing that. When multiple proposals are received from various different vendors, there is a typical scorecard prepared, which does the scoring on the basis of the criteria that the customer has defined and giving an appropriate weightage. For example, the criteria could be on-time delivery. The criteria could be getting the ROI. The criteria could be minimum defect delivery, and so on and so forth. And each one of them getting the right weightage and ratings, and each vendor proposal is scored against it. Now, the sum total of the scores when they are taken, several times it is seen there is hardly any difference that is there between vendor A to vendor B to vendor C, and therefore the customer buying team slightly gets confused or may not be able to really know whether to select A over B or C, and therefore that could be a problem. Now, the decision can go more in a gut feel manner or on the basis of relationship. but not logically convinced about why the customer is selecting A or B vendor, and there could be a doubts coming up. Now, differentiators definitely will help you, but please note that the customer is not interested in knowing the differences just for the sake of it. You know, actually, the customer is trying to see that how the differentiator or unique selling proposition, USPs that you have, are actually value adding. For example, if you have quoted that we are 150,000 strong resource company, well, great, nice. And sometimes I have seen this as a differentiator stated. But the customer is really not concerned about it. I mean, you may have a great number, but the customer procurement person do recollect that last time when I required J2E architect, you are not able to provide it for 3 months, isn't it? So the point is that having a large number of resource base does not really address the customer concerns. If you have a right type of a COE, a people on bench, a right resource profiles in your hand which you are ready to commit, that can become a differentiator as compared to just mentioning 150,000 people strong company. If you fail to give those differentiators appropriately, then the customer thinks that they are buying commodity, and therefore the only way to really arrive at a decision becomes a commodity pricing or the lowest pricing, and that is not really exactly what you want, right? That will do a lot of damage to your own intentions or your own goals that you have. So therefore, it is important that how do we really know what our differentiators are, and please note the differentiators will be unique for the opportunity, and there cannot be generic differentiators across all. So therefore, we need to know the methodology, or need to know not only way to identify the differentiators for a given situation in hand or given opportunity, but as well as ability to map them to the customer value expectations or a value drivers makes a lot of importance. And if you can do that, you are actually doing a bulletproofing against your competition. So one of the things that you really need to learn is how to differentiate to do a huge competition management. And that's a very important part of the proposal strategies, that we are able to do the right competition management strategies, which will give us much higher winning chances. Now we turn to the fifth deadly sin. This is not offering a compelling value proposition. Now I could have taken this as a fourth also, but anyway, order does not really matter. The compelling value proposition means what? That you are promising to the customer that they will get more than what they expect by means of the proposition, by means of the proposals, by means of the various aspects that we are quoting in our proposal, so that they are assured about their own win. And we are focused on customer team win and not just our win. Now, win theme development is one of the most important part that we cover during our intensive workshops, in-person workshops. But the point is that you need to note what customer value expectations are, whether they are on the high quality delivery, whether they are some compliance against some standard, whether it is a least cost solution, whether it is time to market, whatever, the customer value expectations, if they can be mapped to the solution elements that we have, then we have a win theme coming up. By means of mapping, you will come to understand which of those solution elements are most suitable for achieving the customer value expectations. And then based on your brainstorming and identifying those critical solution elements, your entire structure or the win theme becomes guidance to the entire proposal writing, story writing. And that's where most of the smart buyers are very keen to look into that you have understood their requirements as well as value expectations, and you have a way to really map on that and be able to provide a solution on it. So that is a value proposition part of it. Value proposition development or a win theme development will play the central strategic part in your solution development or your entire proposed story development, because we are trying to get what the customer, we are trying to provide what the customer demands the most. Having done that, let's move to the sixth deadly sin, not making it easy to understand and use. Now, many a times the proposals are so difficult to read, like a Russian story, that the customers lose their patience while going through the document. And of course, please be aware that the top management or the executive decision makers have hardly any time and patience to go through, let's say, 100 plus pages of the document. They will read executive summary and they will do a quick skimming through the entire proposal, and that gives them enough insight whether to go ahead or not. Now, if it is not just the executive decision makers, but all other stakeholders also have that need of a very smooth flowing story, a clearly well-structured document, easy language, easy to read and easy to see. Easy to see means easy to see the graphics and other navigational aspects. So that is very important. The clarity is the most essential part of your persuasive communication. So when people don't understand what we are talking about, they usually will not be confident in giving us the budgets that we want. When they are confused or unsure what we are saying, they start doubting whether we have understood the problem. You may actually have both the problem depth of understanding and as well as a right solution for it, but if you do not represent it in a right graphics and a right language, it may not communicate to the customer that you have all that ability, and that confusion will provide. In that case, they will ask additional presentation, they will seek more inputs, but whatever it is, the story is not making sense to them. Now, also using of the language, long sentences, active passive voices, I mean using more passive voice rather than active, or using acronyms and technical jargons are also create a lot of barriers. Another problem, of course, when you see a long complex sentences, while the writer may think that it's very impressive and you are making an intelligent impression, actually it happens the other way around. The customer is required to go back and forth on that long sentence and practically loses the entire essence or may interpret the particular sentences in a different manner. But the length of a proposal as well as the length of the sentences, both if they are very high, it could be really a damaging scenario. In fact, one of the times I say that your chances of winning are inversely proportionate to both the length of the proposal in number of pages as well as average length of sentences. If they are more, the chances of winning are low. So as well as, you know, all those aspects of poorly formatting, not using the proper white spaces and all that. So I'm going to cover that during our last session, last scene that I'm going to cover on. But those are the other semantics or syntactic part of it, which are also important. But here, at the moment, I'm focusing more on a semantic, the story flow, the ability to give a logical, clear flow with the help of which the problem first is defined, the outcomes are very clearly elaborated and well quantified, the solution is given with alternatives and recommendation, and the evidence is clearly made to so as to see that you have understood the you have abilities to provide that solution, is all that logical flow that I'm talking about. There are good information patterns that are available, and I do cover them in our proposal workshops, but those are helpful for bringing up the proposal clarity. So for enhancing the readability of both proposals and executive summary, some of the things that I recommend are following. A, write a short, clear and compelling executive summary. B, write entire proposal with clear, simple sentences. Use active rather than passive voice. C, use suitable font and color. Please note, color also makes a very important sense. Use white spaces liberally and smartly. This is a fourth point. Highlighting as well as uses of quotation graphics all help in readability and quick navigation. Then, fifth point, compliance matrix is a nice navigation tool. In a several government tender, it is must, but I think it should be our best practice. Always use the compliance matrix, giving the map between customer high level requirement and your solution elements, and then a link, a URLs or links to appropriate sections where that has been elaborated, or appropriate annexures where it has been elaborated, is very, very useful. And that compliance matrix becomes the most important navigation tool. Then control the length of the proposal. Less is better, a rule here. Every section, that is this sixth point, every section should be introduced to state what we are covering in the section. This helps the reader to decide whether to go through the section or not. And use annexures for providing details. If you want to write your company overview so as to give the basic things, you may write one or two para at the most in the executive summary. Normally an executive summary should be a 1-page to 2-page. So therefore, based on that, one or two paras in the executive summary. Then in the main proposal, 2 or 3 pages about your company information. And then you may have an annexure, let's say our 15 to 20 pages, give a complete depth and detail of your company. Now, all these three types of helps a lot. The first two paras gives a quick insight. The 1 or 2 pages is useful for all the stakeholders. But if there is some people who are detail oriented, then they actually can go to the annexure and know about your company in depth and detail. So with that, I have covered the sixth deadly sin. And the seventh one is not editing your proposal before delivery, of course, carefully to remove mistakes and the credibility clears. So this is the final thing. And even though it does not seem serious, actually it really creates some major damage. It is a clear sign of a carelessness. What I mean by that, if your proposal has a spelling mistake, grammar mistakes, incomplete sentences, incomplete references, or wrong references, long links, all these are the signs of a carelessness. And naturally, it will kill the entire story very high. In fact, I have seen some of the proposals in which the name of the earlier customer was just carried in. And normally it may not be carried in the main pages or main body of a pages, but somewhere in the header or footer it is carried off. I think that is the deadliest thing. If you will submit a proposal with an earlier customer's or prospect's name, it is a sure shot sign that your proposal is going to thrown in the dustbin. Never do that. It is a clear sign of you are just copy-pasting, not only using the boilerplate or a template, but you are also just picking up the old proposal, changing the names of the customer, and without bothering to really consider what a customer's requirements are, and that could really be a most dangerous thing that you will be doing while the proposal writing. Now, normally it happens that while we read, self-read the proposal and the section owners read, they will normally will not be able to find these problems, because we normally read what we wish to read rather than what it is there in the content. And several times the spelling mistake, grammar and all that actually is overlooked. So therefore it is required a couple of things that you should be doing it. First and foremost, you should have a separate reviewer team. Second, you should have a right type of a checklist that the reviewers will use and will rely on that checklist very heavily. Third, you will use your word processing tool like Microsoft Word to tune up, to identify all such spelling mistakes, grammars and active passive voice problems and so on. And then last but very important, there are various text analytics based tools that are available which will help you in not only knowing the readability scores of your proposal, but reviewing all these errors as well as avoiding the points that you should not be mentioning, or the points that you should be mentioning but you have was failed to do that. Now these types of tools have dictionaries of phrases, and then therefore they are able to do not only quick compliance metrics, they will be able to identify the phrases that should be avoided. They will be able to give you the sections that are missing. They will be able to give you duplicate sentences, long sentences, and a whole lot of readability issues. And if you are familiar with these types of tools, do use them. If you are not, please join our sessions where you will be able to learn more about these aspects very clearly. So these are the 7 deadly sins or problem definitions that I have been working about. And now probably it is a time for looking for your questions. But just before moving to the questions, let me just, because it was last time asked, what is the program structure or how we have structured this workshop. In order to do that, I'm just walking you through the through the site. I hope it is visible on your screens now. There are 2 locations, Pune and Mumbai. At Pune, we are on 13th, 14th May. It's a classroom training base, 9:30 to 6:30. Investment is 20,000 rupees per person. Of course, there are early bird discounts and other discounts available. And similar at a Mumbai, but the dates are different, 20th to 21st May. What are the learning objectives? At quantum jump in your win-bid ratio, solid foundation for high-quality proposals, efficient and effective pre-sales processes, build competency in proposal writing, automate pre-sales process, how to automate that pre-sales process and use various tools for it, and build a knowledge base useful for the pre-sales process covering lessons learned, best practices, case studies, white papers, blogs, reusable contents and so on and so forth. The site also gives 2-day structure starting from the introduction session, day 1, to the challenges faced during the proposal. We use some interesting thinking tools called as mind map for you to really work on and identify the challenges in your organization. Then executive summary case study and how case studies goes wrong. How to do RFP analysis, the session number 9. I'm just quickly walking you through how to do bid no bid decision making and increase your win chances. And then there is an in overview of a finance modeling, net present value, TCO, total cost of ownership, ROI, payback period and all that. And then we quickly give you an introduction both to the risk management and estimation. However, they are not main part of the 2-day session, but it's just an introduction is taken care of. On day 2, we will do the persuasive proposal writing, the primer on persuasion, the value proposition development, the business case development, the competition strategy that I discussed about, then how to do cognitive webbing for the executive summary, how to write proposal, both the executive summary and the proposal in a persuasive manner, what is the language of success and what are the various aspects that you should take care of. And then last, we cover on the how to do proposal reviews before submitting a high quality document to the end customer. So that's generally an overview. You can go through that. If you have any detailed questions on this, then I can address today or in your mails. So at the moment, we are not seeing any questions, so I presume that you probably still have missed. We have still around 10 minutes to go. So I will wait for another 2-3 minutes. If you have any questions, please type using the chat box and I will try to answer them. We are receiving some questions now. I will start answering as they have been receiving. But feel free, you can still use another couple of minutes to put up the more questions. The first question that we have received is, what should be the approach for proposal being submitted for to non-English speaking countries? Now, this is a very nice question, and many a times, particularly for our European customers, we face this challenge. I believe we are comfortable with the English sentences and English language. Therefore, first and foremost, getting that RFP translated into English will be very important, and that is what we really require to take care of, that we understand the right customer expectation by a high quality translation. And the same could be after you have prepared your entire proposal in English language, can be useful for submitting for translating team. Here, of course, I am assuming that you have a right translation team in-house, or it could be an other outsource vendor who should be giving the high quality translation. But as far as your own team is concerned, it will be able to do an effective work, collaborate and communicate effectively only in case you will work with the language which you are most comfortable, and I'm presuming that language is English, and that is what the approach I think is the best suitable for. The second question is the estimation for project and RFP submission are same? Of course, this is a question that I have received from Rahul Bhattacharya. Yes, Rahul, the proposal time estimation is the most critical estimation, and that is what gives basis for negotiating and contracting to the customer. Now, even if you are doing time and material based, the number of resources that will be that you require for giving the services, considering the service level agreement SLAs, is also an estimation. So therefore, SLAs based time and material resource ramp up, ramp down, or the effort budget, or the duration, all these are estimations. They are most critical during the proposal stage. They become basis for negotiation and contracting, and therefore it is a very important foundation stone for not only winning as well as completely successfully completing the project. If you do a pessimistic estimation, you may lose and you may not have any further problem. If you do too optimistic an estimation, you may win, but you will face a challenge during the project execution. Therefore, estimation is one of the most important aspects of the proposal stage. I think I have addressed this question. The next question comes from Priti. She is asking, can the paid session be taken by someone who wants to learn proposal writing afresh? Yes, we do assume that the audience, the attendees, will not be really completely familiar with proposal writing. I have conducted several workshops which were totally for the people who were first time hearing the word called as RFP also, or they have never got an experience of what is proposal writing. You can still attend it. Of course, there are some more additional work that you will have to do, that we will do with the help of a distributing appropriate reading material prior to the workshops, and that can prepare you slightly better. But we do not assume that you have a high depth of experience. Now, prior to actual workshop, we do a survey of the participants and understand at what level of maturity or what level of competence the attendees of the workshop are, and based on that we try to tune up. But if there is one or two fresh persons, we can take them separately offline during the workshops to take care of their initial knowledge constraints. Now, next question is coming from Dharmender. What are the common mistakes people commit while writing the proposal, and what practices one should follow to avoid such? Now, Dharmender, the common mistakes that that people normally commit is what I covered during the session today. These are the things like not knowing about your customer well, or inability to do differentiation, or not I have an ability to develop a win theme. All those are types of common mistakes. The language parts that I discussed in there are also common mistakes. However, there are other areas of problems which are supporting to the proposal writing, which are of course your relationship with your customer, or your pre-sales process, right from registering the RFP or opportunity to doing the RFP analysis, to bid, no bid, the entire proposal process that you have, the proposal writing process is also a very equally important part of it. The type of tools that you use, not only Microsoft Word for creating that proposal document, but the review tools, the collaborative review tools, the lexical analytical tools, the dashboards that are required, and various collaboration tools that are required, all of them play a very important part. If they are not properly creating an environment which is required for collaborative proposal development, that could be a big problem. And some of them we'll discuss and we'll cover deep dive in that. But today, that seven deadly sins that I have covered are the most important common problem practices that we have. Now, what practices are the common problems that people have during proposal writing? What practices one should follow to avoid such mistake? Wait for the third webinar. I am going to cover, give an overview of that, and we will do a deep practice of various techniques, methodologies, which will help you in avoiding these problems and creating high value, high persuasive, high quality proposal documents during our workshops. So I think that addresses your question. The last, the another question that have come is from Alia. So thank you for such an informative webinar. My question is, what is an ideal average length of a proposal according to you? Very nice. There is nothing like an ideal way because it depends upon the size of an RFP. But moment, please note, if moment your proposal crosses the length of 100 pages, that means you have to do a lot of structure thinking. That is important. Ideally, the main proposal should be anywhere between 20 to 25 pages, and remaining should be annexures, supplementary documents, your certifications and all other supporting material that you wish to submit. So to my mind, around 25 to 30 pages should be a good size, covering 2 to 3 pages executive summary and the remaining giving the main contents. The sections, the annexures will be the remaining sections that can be coming in future. Okay, now the next question is coming up from Malvin. He is asking how to read customer's mind regarding RFP. Is it advisable if we number figures, graphs and diagrams in our proposal? Now reading customer's mind is a big thing that he has brought into picture. There are two parts, or at least three parts, that I am going to cover in the next session. But just quickly mentioning on that, first and foremost, there is something called as an account management relationship, which gives you a lot of insight about the customer's current mindset, the business drivers, the challenges, the pains, the competition scenarios, and so on and so forth. Then there is a process called as a capture planning, which is focuses specifically on the customer, that particular opportunity. And the last, which we will cover in depth in our workshop, is called as an RFP analysis, which will help you in getting a much better, clear idea about the customer's intentions, expectations, risk, fears, and so on and so forth during our proposal workshop. So now, is it advisable if we number figures, graphs, and diagrams in our proposal? Absolutely, yes. It is very much advisable that you should number your figures, graphs, and diagrams. Not only that, every figure diagram should have a caption, which should have been three part. One is it first, it is a number, figure number so and so forth, diagram number so and so forth, followed by eye-catching phrase or a description of that, let's say ROI graph or something like that. And then briefly, what is the benefit out of that particular diagram? For example, quality process and our quality, agile project management method helping to deliver on time within delivery, within on time and within budget, that type of. So every graph or every figure becomes sort of a very interesting way through which you are you are giving your strong messages, and while various executive decision makers or others skimming through your proposal, those catches very, very high attention. And therefore, it is not just advisable, I will say it is must to do a justice on giving right type of figures, graphs and diagrams equal with correct captions for that. Another question Malvin asked, how to handle evidence of success if we have provided RFP to a customer for the first time for his domain. Very nice. Now, this is a depth of discussion during the workshop. However, let me quickly give you an insight that even if you are first time working in the domain, you may have worked on the similar type of a domains. In a sense, let's say you might have worked on ERPs. Now, currently you are addressing telecom domain, but you might have worked on ERPs or SAPs and ERP-based implementation solution or ERP-based bolt-on development solution, let's say for auto and others. So therefore, at least from a technology point of view, you are quite capable, and you can quote that experience by providing appropriate case studies. Normally, evidence is given in three different things. The things that we talk about ourselves, particularly something like our methodologies, our processes, description of our quality management and all that is the aspects that we are talk about ourselves. Then there are things that our customers talk about us. For example, the case studies, the references, and all that comes in that section that a customer. In this case, you may not have the right domain reference case study, but you may still give the reference case study from other parallel domain and also other parallel technology, also as well as give the case study of handling the situations like a large team offshore or ability to manage SLAs and so on and so forth. So domain knowledge being your limitation, you have to address it with the help of a right profiles and others, but other aspects like project management or the technology or the resource management or risk management, you must be having experience from other domains, and that could be a very interesting way to give through this case, through the case studies that you can provide for. And the third way in which evidence is given is what the third parties talk about us. For example, the accreditation, for example, CMMI accreditations or ISO 9000 or ISO 27000 and all others, or the accolades or prizes that you have won during the industry summits and others could also be a very important evidence elements to demonstrate your capabilities. So you still have some limitations because you do not have a domain expertise or your first time addressing, but you can try to compete with the help of all other scenarios. I hope I address your question. More detailed discussion can be done during our sessions. Now, last question that is coming from Priti again. What level of domain knowledge does a proposal writer need to have? Proposal writer himself or herself may not be a domain expert, but the domain team plays a very, very critical role in terms of understanding the domain issues. There could be domain standards issues, there could be specific terms and language terms of that particular domain, there could be metrics which are very critical for that domain, there are some industry trend or domain trends that you should be aware about it. If you do not know the business domain, your ability to provide a technology solution which is going to solve domain problem is very, very limited. And therefore, if you are not domain expert, you should be at least domain aware, guided by a subject matter expert or a domain team or a business analyst, and then only your success chances will go up. So I think we have crossed around 5 to 7 minutes on the top of our schedule limits, but thanks. There are a lot many interesting questions you guys really posted to me. Just a quick reminder to you, 5th May, the next Friday, we have third and the last session, last webinar session. I'm going to focus it on the art and science of persuasion. And there are some aspects that I have covered today. We will go in depth and detail, and it will give at least some areas of overview. This subject of proposal writing is a large and complex, but it will give you a good amount of beginning insight of the proposal writing. And I'm very sure during our proposal workshop over 2 days, you will start getting all the inputs, all methods, tools and techniques which you can start applying in for your next opportunity and start winning the proposals. So that's all we have just now. We'll end at this moment, hoping that you like this. We have just two polls that is coming up, which I missed. So first poll, so quick response, will just not take more than 2 to 3 minutes, be online. Okay. So, let's see, 50%. So close to 40% people responded to this poll, and it is equally divided. That is around 57% of the attendees says that they are PMI certified, and around 43% say that they are not. Okay, let me check, select one more, and this is last one. Do you find this webinar series useful? Around 25 seconds have passed. Close to 57% have voted for it. Let me wait for another 10 seconds and then. Okay. In the first minute of the poll, around 64% voted, and all you have voted, 100% said yes, that this webinar series, you find it useful. Thank you very much. It is really encouraging to get this type of a feedback. I hope you have enjoyed this session, and with that, we will end today's session. Wish you a very nice weekend, and hope you will see me not only in the next webinar, but during the actual workshops. Thank you very much. We will close at this moment.